I'd just like to say something on behalf Are we ready for Right. But if you want just a lobster tail, a pound of lobster tail, had for dinner last night, what would your answer be? Many of you might say for something yummy, because it's probably something you can all relate to. What I had for dinner, I had cornflakes, I had pecans, I had ice cream, I had chicken. I worked all day at Sabres yesterday. I came home, I could eat the house. So I just kept going. So food choices varies with culture. Get this. Food choices varies with culture, people, countries, income, and of course, choice. You can choose to eat what you want to eat, right? And our scripture today from the book of Numbers, chapter 11, we learn that the children of Israel were enslaved in Egypt for almost 400 years. And after so many years, they had adapted to the food culture of Egypt. They had many food choices. They grew accustomed to it. They ate fish, according to Numbers 11, verse 5. Fish, cucumbers, melons, leeks. We know what leeks are. It's a vegetable, a vegetable, part of the onion family. And they had onion and garlic. And as we already know, they were under the leadership of Moses. They were carried out of bondage. They encamped in the wilderness. And as they waited to be led into the promised land, they got hungry. And as they got hungry, they got angry. And they quarreled with Moses because they wondered, where would their food source come from? Moses, they said, brought them to a strange place to die from hunger. And then they said, Moses, if this is how we are going to die in the wilderness from hunger, take us back to Egypt, where we can find food. We crave the fish, the cucumbers, the melons, and everything else, and we have nothing here to eat. When you and I go to the grocery store, what do we buy? I buy the same thing every week. I don't know about you. Because if I bring home something new, or if you bring home something new to your family, you might have a fight on your hands, right? We don't eat what we don't recognize. We've never tasted that before. We don't want it. But in the wilderness, God had a better plan, a better diet plan for his children. He gave them angelic food that they were not accustomed to. Manna is what the angels eat. I think I mentioned that earlier. Don't think that they are up in heaven just playing music. They all eat. They don't eat what we eat. So God gave the children of Israel manna to eat. And it was spiritual food. But the children of Israel, they did not know that. Spiritually, they were eating heavenly meals on earth. It didn't fit. And they could not understand that. But God thought that coming out of bondage, manna was the right food for the children of Israel. But they complained. They said it tasted like oil, cooking oil. They did not like the taste, and they complained. They went into their tents, and they cried to Moses, and their tears enraged the Lord. The anger of the Lord was kindled, and God said, okay, I gave them manna, the food that we eat in heaven, and they don't want it. So I'll give them meat. If they want meat, I'll give them chicken. So we know that God called Moses and had a chat with him. And a winged, the scriptures are very funny, a winged came from the Lord. And before we know it, the Lord brought quails from the sea and allowed the quails to fall by the camp round about in hills. We know what a quail is, right? It's a little baby bird. Children, are you familiar with a quail? So they wanted chicken. God gave them chicken. And today, many of us are blessed to have more than we can eat. We are blessed that we can make decisions as to what we want to eat. What did Jesus eat? Have we ever wondered what he ate? And according to the scriptures, we know he ate a lot of fish. Jesus himself cooked fish after the resurrection. We know that he roasted fish for the disciples. He had lots of bread. Jesus blessed loaves and fish. Jesus had chicken wings. Lots of chicken. How do we know that? Before he was crucified, before he was tried, remember he said to Peter, before the cock crows, you will deny me. Where did the chicken come from? Okay. So Jesus had chicken, he had eggs, meat, olives, almonds, figs. We know on the Sabbath day he went into the bush, he saw a fig tree, and there was no figs on it. We know that, right? Dates and pomegranates. He may have eaten other things too, but the scriptures do not say that. This is what we know for sure, what he ate. So the next time you go to the grocery store, we can think about the thousands who have nothing to eat. No fish, no cucumbers, no onions, no iguanas, any pickles. I'm still not comfortable with that. I don't think I'd ever be comfortable with an iguana as food. But they say one man's meat is another man's poison, right? So one man's poison is another man's meat. And today, God is calling us into his fold to feast at his table with spiritual nourishment. God's spiritual food is the body. Can I get an amen? So are you feasting on the word of God today? You can start your own spiritual feast by picking a few verses in the Bible and meditating on them every day and every night. Every day I meditate on Psalm 34. I meditate on Psalm 86. Psalm 86. I know there are 139. How many Psalms are there in the Bible? 139? Psalm 86, God has one psalm that he cherishes. I don't know how he does that. Psalm 86, you can make a note of that. One day we will get into why it is his favorite psalm. When you have a chance this week, I want you to read it. Psalm 86. I know it works. I'm not just here saying what I don't know. When my son was born 3.5 months prematurely, and the doctor said there was no way that he would survive, I said, yes, he will. And they all looked at me like I had many heads. I knew what I was saying, because in a dream, the hospital by a nurse with LASIK. He just had to leave. He went through many challenges. Every day it was something with his heart rate. There was one day I just gave up. I just said, okay, just let him go. And he would bounce back. And then I forgot that my mom gave birth to 10 children, 9 of us are surviving. And as I mentioned to you maybe sometime, I was the runt of the litter. I died many times when I was a child, you could ask my mom. And she will tell the stories that she got a shoebox and put it by my bed. And she said, anytime now, anytime. She chased my dad out of the room and she said, I want this moment just with me and this child. Anytime now, it's going to go. Anytime. And she is counting the time. And I took one last breath and she said, this is it. It's gone. And then I came back again a couple minutes later. Ah, I'm still here. It's a long story. The DNA is on, and I knew that this child would survive, and today he's 23. I just wanted to elaborate on Psalm 86. I'm not making that up. You don't have to believe me, but I do know these things. So the next time that you go to the grocery store and you do your grocery shopping, always think about those who have nothing to eat. Always think about what you can do to help. You don't have to give your life savings, but you can donate to your regular food pantry. It could be in town, out of town. Never hesitate when you see someone on the street with palms upward begging. How do we know who this person is? It could be Jesus looking right at you. That is hard to believe. Jesus can come to us in any form. Always remember, he never came to earth riding on a white horse, wearing fine robes and a ring on his finger, or wearing purple. In those days, purple was the color of money. You wore purple, you were rich. He came to us as nothing. And then he said to us, we came in as nothing, and when we leave with nothing. Wonder about that. God is calling us today to feast on his word in the Bible. Start with a song. Start with your favorite verse. If you don't know any verses in the Bible, just start with Genesis 1:1. That's easy. In the beginning, the Bible begins with a preposition in the beginning, God. There was a beginning, therefore there will be an end. That's your verse right there. And you can take it to whatever levels you want. But we know that in the last days, only those who are fortified with truth, God, will be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. Someone can come and tell us anything about the Bible and we will believe it, right? We have to know the truth. When many will approach you trying to condemn the Word of God, our only condemnation has always been this. It is not Bible study, as some of us may think. It is the Word of God. And every time we come to church and we speak about the Word, we know that we are glorifying God. We know in Revelation chapter 2, Jesus visited the 7 Christian churches in those days, and he told each one of them what they were doing right and what they were doing wrong. And I want to stress that God appoints an angel, a spirit, to every church in this world. There are many angels who go around. We cannot see the angel, It's not our job to see it, because if we see it, we'll all go running. God assigns an angel to every church. They take the minutes every Sunday or whenever we worship, and they take it back up there. Someday when we get up there, you will say, oh, she used to talk about that. That's what she meant. It will not make sense to you right now, but I just have to tell you that the Word of God can never die, no matter what we say or do. We cannot rewrite this book. It is already well written. The Word of God is quick. It is powerful. It is sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing to the dividing asunder of the soul and spirit and the joint and marrow. The Word of God, the Bible, is a discerner of the thoughts of the intents of the heart. God knows what we're thinking, even before we open our hearts. Jesus said, it is never what we put into our mouth that defiles us. It's what comes out of our mouth. We are reminded to be kind every day to one another. We may not always agree on everything, but there's a nice way we can say things, and there is a not so nice way we can say things. We are Christians. We are called to be a light in the world, a light to ourselves, to those around us, that others will see the glory of God in us and glorify Jesus in heaven. Amen.
Amen.
Our next hymn comes from the Red Hymnal, hymn number 327, and we are asking God to lead us.
Thank you.
service for our grandson Anthony, who is going off to college.
worldwide, Bob and Joanne, the people of Ukraine and Russia, Jackie and Joanne, to all the bus drivers, we pray for all the doctors and all the nurses worldwide. We pray for all the children of the world, those who are suffering, those who are being abused silently. Father, we pray that as adults, we can have more love for the children. We can show a little more respect and be a little more embracing. The children are the leaders, all the leaders of tomorrow. Whatever we sow into them, this is what we will reap. Let us instill God into their lives at an early age, so that one day when they become men and women of tomorrow, they can also pass on the word of God to their children and their children's children. The word of God is alive and well, and as seed, we have to keep it growing in the church, in the community, and elsewhere. We must remember to lead a life that is pleasing in the light of God. Light of the world, we ask you this day to shine on us. To shine on those who are here, bless everyone sitting here today. And also bless those who could not be here this morning. Those who we count as not worthy. Those who we think are lesser than us, in the eyes of God, we are all children of God, red, yellow, black, and white. Whatever gender we belong to, we are all God's children. And we pray that we can always reach out a helping hand to our friends and neighbors in need. We ask all of this, dear Lord, that you will keep the love flowing between us in this church. You will keep the love flowing between us at home, in our families, at our friends, on the job,